You've been watching your late great movie connection, Cable 7, Channel 57, Citytv. Well, we made their day.
About it.
I'm not worried. I'm frustrated. I've been working my part for the last 2 weeks and I still don't know it.
Come on, Alex. You know how to act. That's why Mr. Barnes picked you for the part.
Yeah, but ever since I made that mistake at the first rehearsal, I haven't been able to get it right. I thought I had it memorized. How long did it take you to get your part down?
Just a couple of nights, but I just got a small part.
And so we must build an ark, a giant boat that will house our families.
And every animal and bird on Earth.
But how will we do that?
We will only take one male from each species and its mate.
But how large should the ark be?
The ark must be, it has to be...
300 cubits long.
300 cubits long.
Try it again, Alex.
But how large should the ark be?
The ark must be 300 cubits long, 50 cubits wide, and 30 cubits high. As I stand on this rock, I say that we should...
Okay, that's fine.
Oh, no, I forgot to stand on the rock.
Oh, Alex. That was just fine, Alex, except for that last part.
I just can't get that walk over and that line. It's the word that throws me.
You're trying too hard. You're frustrating yourself by trying too hard.
But how can I get it right?
By relaxing more. It's one thing to make a mistake. Anyone can make a mistake. But it's another thing to make that mistake a problem.
Can I try it again?
No, that's enough for today. Why don't you go home and play some baseball? Forget about the play. You'll see, tomorrow you'll get it right.
Okay.
And Alex, I've said it before, you're a very promising actor.
Bye.
Goodbye.
But how will we do that?
We will only take one male from each species and its mate.
But how large should the ark be?
The ark must be, it has to be...
Try it again, Alex.
Oh, no, I forgot to stand on a rock.
Trying too hard. You're frustrating yourself by trying too hard.
But how can I get it right?
You're just trying too hard.
That's what everybody keeps saying, and it...
bugs you, I know, Alex.
You're the one who's always telling me that practice makes perfect, so that's what I'm doing, practicing.
That's true, Alex, but sometimes failure can be caused by too much effort as well as by too little. Where are you going?
To cut the lawn.
Listen, Alex, you don't have to cut the lawn today.
All right.
So we must build an ark, a giant boat that will house our families. And every animal and bird on Earth. We will only take one male from each species and its mate. The ark must be 300 cubits long, 50 cubits wide, and 30 cubits high. And as I stand on this rock, I say that we should start working on the ark right away before the floods come.
I've never seen you working so hard in your life, Alex. And what are you doing standing on that bench? It's a pretty funny way to study for an exam.
I'm working my part for the play. I just can't seem to get the whole thing together. There's this one line I just can't remember. And even if I do remember it, I forget to do my movement.
I used to have trouble remembering things. It used to happen all the time. Just when I tried to remember the right word for an exam or anything, my mind went blank.
It did? What did you do?
Well, I'll tell you a secret. Whenever I had a word I couldn't remember, I thought of another word which would remind me of the word I couldn't remember.
What do you mean?
Well, when I was taking out your mother before we were married, I was always nervous when I had to pick her up because I could never remember her father's name.
What did you do?
His name was Lockhart. So I thought of a word that would remind me of it.
What was the word?
Lockjaw. What's a word you can't remember?
Well, it's the word cubit. I try so hard to remember it, but even if I do get it, I forget to stand on the rock, and I have to stand on the rock to finish my speech.
Well, instead of cubits, just think of the word cubits. Maybe that will help. Go on, give it a try. I'll be your audience.
And so we must build an ark, a giant boat that will house our families and every animal and bird on Earth. And we will only take one male from each species and its mate. And the ark must be 300 cubits long, 50 cubits wide, and 30 cubits high. And as I stand on this rock, I say that we should start working on the ark right away before the floods come.
You did it! Come on, let's go play some ball, eh?
Now, this is our last rehearsal before the performance tomorrow night. So I want you to remember all you've learned and remember your cues. Are there any questions?
No.
Now, take your positions. And curtain up.
But Noah says there's going to be a flood. Every living thing on Earth...
Tell you a little secret. Whenever I had a word that I couldn't remember, I thought of another word which would remind me of the word I couldn't remember.
Someone told him.
And so we must build an ark. A giant boat that will house our families and every animal and bird on Earth.
But how should we do that?
We will only take one male from each species and its mate.
But how large should the ark be?
The ark must be 300 cubits long.
All right. Now try it again, Alex. You can do it. Give him the cue, Doreen.
But how large should the ark be?
The ark must be 300 cubits long, 50 cubits wide, and 30 cubits high. As I stand on this rock, I say that we should start working on the ark right away before the floods come.
The rock. You forgot the rock.
What?
The rock.
It was just great, Alex, but you forgot the rock.
Oh, no.
If you were Alex, what would you do?
I'm just looking for a lost sock. From Parliament and Carlton, this is Citytv, everywhere.
To many college and university students, management is the set of desirable positions within a given organization. To a new, somewhat nervous employee, management refers to the unknown force above, the big brass who make all the decisions. To many of us, management is where the rules and regulations come from. Perhaps then, managers exist simply to keep employees in line. Corporate babysitters, if you like, on behalf of the company. We all know that's not true. We've all worked for managers, perhaps even been one. Why then is there such a lack of agreement on this simple question? When you hear the word management, what do you think of?
I think mostly of trying to accomplish tasks by getting somebody else to do it, I guess.
Upper echelon, orders. Respect, or it should be. cooperation, friendliness, firmness.
Oh, management, either a person or a group of people who sort of have it all together and they're sort of organizing a larger group of people.
Responsibility.
To get the most out of a group of people.
I think of Bay Street and men in three-piece suits.
I think fundamentally that it's I think of the management of resources, the ability to deal with resources, both human, capital, and physical, and to accomplish some form of result.
The way we each perceive management, as for any phenomenon, is greatly affected by the managers with whom we have come in contact during our lifetime. Since managers are people, no two are alike. Thus, the definition of management becomes clouded by a more interesting and challenging question. What constitutes a good manager?
Strong leadership, decision-making, fast decision-making sometimes.
Somebody who's in tune with his employees, their feelings, and somebody who's not sort of, do this, do that. A person who is a people person.
One who probably thinks highly of people, who has some version of the variety of talents that people have, who works on the getting the best out of his people towards some good end result.
Honesty, integrity, and again, I think responsibility is the most important. To the person, to the company the manager represents, and to the people under his care.
I think a good manager has to have analytical capabilities, the ability to analyze a problem and determine which of the three resources can be best brought to bear on the solution. But most important of all, I think, is the ability to realize that the greatest resource he has to use is the human resource, the people, and how he can motivate and get the willing cooperation of the people who report to him and whom he manages to accomplish specific corporate or organizational objectives.
Management itself is a process, the process of achieving goals through others. Teachers motivate students to learn. A hockey coach motivates his team members to perform. A business manager motivates employees towards corporate goals. Managers, thus, are individuals who have been assigned the responsibility of working through others and have been given the authority by title to do so. Indeed, managers can be found in many shapes, sizes, ages, and environments. There is an unfounded tendency to associate management positions with large, white-collar environments. In reality, the process of organizing, directing and motivating, planning and controlling exists necessarily in all work situations. Persons who feel that they may enjoy performing a management role are therefore not locked into office environments. Some individuals make a career out of managing people and move from company to company in order to find new environments in which to do it. Unfortunately, many individuals discover a management career by accident. An individual often finds himself promoted to a first-level management or supervisory position simply because he or she performed well on the job. In a sink-or-swim situation, the individual attempts to develop what are known as management skills. Perhaps the biggest adjustment is learning how to do through others rather than doing the work oneself. By trial and error, the new manager finds that certain methods, procedures, and tactics are more successful than others in dealing with employees. It is natural, then, that these tactics are repeated, groomed and repeated again. A management style is created. Every manager has an individual style, an approach which he or she feels is the secret recipe to success. Unfortunately, some approaches are more effective than others. We spoke with Mr. Jack Hurlbut, president of Advanced Management Enterprises Limited, who is a specialist in management science and spends a portion of each day actually advising and consulting managers. To contrast, We also gathered a sampling of managers from various authority levels and work environments in order to discuss their personal viewpoints.
Well, a manager basically is somebody who is directing the activities of others, usually governed by a policy guideline that's been handed to him, and with an objective of directing those activities in a very efficient manner to create at the end, as an end result, some form of customer satisfaction. And when that's done and done very efficiently, there's normally a resulting reward, which we call profit.
I think a manager is someone who takes a number of resources and allocates those resources to maximize the return, while at the same time having to balance the satisfaction or motivation concerns of the people working for him or her. The best managers, the more senior manager a manager becomes, the better ones become more concerned with people.
To me, management simply means getting the job done by either leadership or by guidance, by discussion. Basically, the manager has the overall responsibility for what is produced at the end.
I'm assuming technical competence, of course, but and leadership is a whole lot of things. Of course, it's energy, it's vitality, it's concern for people, it's an enthusiasm for the world and for the business you're in. It's a preparedness to be human and not a dictator, to show some human frailties, to empathize with the problems of your subordinates, to pat them on the back when they do a great job, and just criticize them constructively when they don't, making sure that they learn when they make a mistake, and to understand yourself that you sure aren't, as a manager, perfect, so that you learn from the people you work for you as well as the ones you work for.
Do you believe that there is such a thing as management skill?
The kind of skills that most good managers possess include written and verbal communication skills. Somebody who cannot communicate can't generally be a very good manager, because you're managing people in most managerial situations, of course. I guess a couple of other things come to mind. One is an enthusiasm for the job that's demonstrated day in and day out, no matter how tired you become or how frustrated you become yourself, because you've got to make other people feel that you are leading and that you are setting a standard day in and day out, every week of the year. And that's not always easy. And then you have to translate the goals and objectives of the corporation, as I said earlier, into meaningful tasks, meaningful objectives for those that work for you.
You have to have an ability to deal with people, that is hiring, promotion, training, development, and firing of staff. You have to be able to organize. You have to be able to plan. And I think more than that, you've got to have a sense of a wholeness of the organization, where it's going, how all the parts fit together, and where they lead down the path. And that is the sort of mysterious skill of management, I guess, that either you have it or you don't.
I referred earlier to the fact that management is a science, and as such, it's not necessary to be born a manager. There are certain personality characteristics that will make you or assist you in being a very effective manager. But as a science, the skills can be learned, and provided they're faithfully practiced and hopefully with a degree of sincerity, you will be an effective manager.
Once an individual has developed management skills, are these unique to that company or to that particular industry?
I don't think so. The skills I just talked about are very translatable and across different industries and different companies.
No, the science of management is universal. It's transportable. That's why management education is so valuable. It will serve you in almost every situation or every industry. The variable is the technology of the industry, and it is necessary to learn that technology as you move from one industry to another. But the principles of management, the science of management, is basic and universal and continuing.
If an individual has proven to be very effective and very efficient in a given job or in operations, does that necessarily mean that he or she will make a good manager?
No, you're talking about the difference between a worker and a supervisor. No, the difference between those two functions is about as different as that of a truck driver and an educator. There are really no similarities there. It will tell you, I suppose, that the individual is very reliable, very conscientious, but those factors alone will not make them a good supervisor.
Not by definition, necessarily, no, because somebody can do a very technically oriented job and be very, very happy in it and do it very well, but not have some of the skills I referred to earlier. Not want to be a leader, or not interested in being a leader, not interested in taking problems home with them, or working until 8 o'clock or 9 o'clock at night on occasion. Not really interested in climbing up the corporate ladder, if you would. So it doesn't, by definition, mean that you'll be a good manager.
In theory, we often hear that the function of management is fivefold. Could you elaborate on this?
Yes, that is a good, correct theory. Management is a science, and the five basic functions are planning, organizing, coordinating, supervising, and controlling. The first function is often preceded by the word forecasting, because it's very difficult to do any planning without doing some forecasting first. And those functions are inherent in every management job. It's a question of degree as to the level of management being practiced, as to how much time will be spent in each of those basic functions.
Can you give a typical example of a level of management and possible function that they may concentrate more on?
Yes, an S1 or a first line supervisor, that's someone who's directly responsible for the work of producing workers. The experience says that at that level, the individual will spend perhaps about 80% of his time in the supervising function, which encompasses all of the personnel management areas, and perhaps only 5% of his time in the planning function. A dramatic comparison with that would be a chief executive in a large company who would almost reverse that process and spend about 80% of his time in the planning function and perhaps only 5% in the supervising function.
How much direction do you think a manager should provide for his or her employees?
Well, that's, again, a question of degree. The simple answer is you provide as much as is necessary. Too close a supervision is counterproductive. And yet the manager cannot abdicate entirely his responsibility for results. Almost everything he does is delegated, but he cannot ignore the responsibility for follow-up once having made the delegation. And it varies, again, almost from employee to employee. Some employees require very little supervision and appreciate the fact that you demonstrate confidence by checking only infrequently on them. And others will require a higher degree, perhaps not because of attitude, but just because of lack of skills at that particular stage in their development. So when you're starting out with a new employee, you're checking fairly frequently and fairly closely, and as they demonstrate that they can do the job, you back off and reduce that frequency of follow-through.
Directing the staff, again, the way I work, once you have the right people in place, have given them at the beginning clear guidelines and regular evaluations, that's all the direction you really need to do. I have found that the more responsibility that people have, if they have very clear guidelines and very clear evaluation, the better they will do.
If their personality shows that they have the capabilities and the talent and the skills and the innovativeness and they are self-motivated, then I think I need a lesser degree. And I think the people are happier with that. They can get on with what they want to be doing. They're sort of staying in it's almost like a string. You're going back and forth, just checking in, just making sure that you're not going too far, of course. None of us want to waste time. But then there is the other type of employee who not so much needs the direction, but needs the acknowledgement that you know what they are doing. And I think that that personal feedback is very important to those types of people.
Well, it's what we talk about, the difference between supervision and snoopervision. People, generally speaking, do not like to have someone hanging over their shoulder observing everything they're doing. It tends to make them nervous, and they become overcautious. They slow down in their work to achieve accuracy at the sake of speed. And just generally speaking, we prefer not to have close supervision because we all operate better without somebody breathing down our necks or putting that undue pressure on us in that fashion.
Is there an optimum amount of control that a manager should try and maintain over an employee's work?
Okay, the first point there is that the best control in any organization is the first line supervisor, because he in fact is supervising the productive work that's taking place. And that's what the whole organization is all about. All levels above that are geared to transmit the objectives of top management down to the worker and hopefully see it carried out there in an efficient and effective manner. The question of an optimum degree of control in that sense is a bit of a cloudy word, because control normally takes two forms. It is the control through accounting and reporting, and the other is control through inspection. And both are necessary. And the question as to how much control you exert is based on the law of diminishing returns.
Education, background, style. I think that when you are in a position of having employees, I think you do have to look at them each on an individual basis and assess their background, style, personality, and see if you can work within that. Yes, a certain amount of control has to be had, because there should be some reporting structure, whereas you know what people are basically doing with their time. I think that with me, that goes on for an evaluation period, and then I make a judgment as to how I am going to continue on operating with this person.
Control is a very necessary thing, so you can't ignore it. But the control by inspection can be relaxed based on the quality of the workforce. The control by accounting and reporting can never be relaxed. It's necessary. It must be done. It's the final measurement of the plan. It tells you whether, in fact, the plan that you developed and the policy and objectives that stemmed from that plan and all of the intermediate steps, it measures the effectiveness of that. It says your controls say this is what we said would happen and this is what did happen.
How can a manager be sure that the work environment doesn't change just because he or she is not physically present?
He can't be, but I think if we go back to the first four functions that you discussed, that if all those are in place and running smoothly, that he won't have to worry too much, that he will have the right staff, he will have the right organization, he will have the right plans, so that the control really is a minor part of the operation.
I think it relates back to our earlier comments on the quality of the workforce. If you in fact have engaged people who are already well motivated, and you have set up the structure that's going to give them satisfaction in the job and encourage them to perform to their maximum, and this goes on all the time while you're there, it's unlikely that they're going to reverse their attitudes when you're not there.
Let's talk a little bit about management decision making. First of all, we often hear about making decisions with a risk factor involved. Can you elaborate on this?
Well, if all of the information and facts required by a manager to make a decision were available, there isn't much to decision making. The facts normally speak for themselves. But in business, It isn't always possible to obtain all of the facts, and it isn't always possible to defer decisions long enough to obtain all of the facts, or even a high percentage of the facts. So the risk element occurs when the manager makes a decision based on partial information and injects into that decision his own education, his experience, and his feel for the situation. We talk about gut reactions, but in fact what we have up in our head is the equivalent of a very fine computer. And when those decisions roll out, they are a product of all that's been fed into that computer for a period of years and the immediate information given to them. So there is a risk factor, but the good manager will have a fairly low risk factor, although it's said that you only have to be right 51% of the time to be a successful manager.
I think that if you have common sense, a sense of humor, a reputation for fairness, then people will say, okay, everybody makes mistakes. If you are a martinet who insists on meticulous performance from your staff, then I don't think your staff is going to forgive you many mistakes. But I've always believed that really, if you make the right decision 70% of the time, you're pretty good. Most of us don't. Most of us probably hit about 60% of right decisions, 40% of wrong ones.
The problem that managers encounter is if they have set themselves up to be a mini-god and infallible, and then when a mistake is made, the employees gleefully pounce on that and say, aha, I told you he wasn't worth a darn anyways.
Is authority the same thing as power?
I don't believe there is such a thing as power except in very limited and immediate situations. The man who is behind this camera has the power to turn it off and make us blank. He probably doesn't have the authority to turn it off and make it blank. So I think that power is really an elusive kind of buzzword which rarely exists in a very direct and controllable situation anymore. Maybe it did once when kings used to cut off people's head at the mere sign of disobedience. But today we live in a pluralistic, democratic and consensual world.
Would you define for us what it means to delegate?
Well, I guess the simplest answer is to let someone else do it and to take the credit after they've done it well and take the blame after they've done it badly. I guess the real answer is to allow a person to participate in the running of your department or in the functioning of your department up to the level of his possible ability, with clear guidelines and with an evaluation, but without much control in between.
Delegation is first of all, sitting down and seeing what your responsibilities are and then identifying those that you are going to delegate. Then you determine who you're going to delegate them to. You call in that delegatee and you discuss the proposed delegation with them, get their understanding and acceptance of it. Then you sit down with everybody who's going to be affected by that change and say, this is John Doe, who you all know. As of today, I have delegated to him these particular responsibilities. He is now responsible for them, and I would appreciate that the fact that all of you will cooperate with him in helping him to carry them out.
Going back to the example on delegation, who retains the ultimate accountability for that given task?
The person originally charged with the responsibility, in the case of an S1, the manager retains that responsibility. He can delegate the task, he can delegate the authority, but he can never get rid of the responsibility or accountability for that. That's his. The buck stops there.
Okay, perhaps you can just explain for us then the relationships between authority, responsibility, and accountability.
Well, one is first assigned responsibility and must be assigned at the same time commensurate authority to carry out that responsibility. At any level, accountability exists. We are responsible and accountable to some supervisor. If it's a chief executive officer, it's his board he's responsible to. If it's the directors, it's the shareholders they're responsible to and accountable. It's they're all tied together, linked together. You can't divorce the one. It's, if you have responsibility, you must be given commensurate authority to carry it out, and you must recognize that you are accountable to somebody for that, and be prepared to report in the proper fashion.
Every manager likes to believe that he is a good one. The style he adopts is a function of his personality, experience, and education. Too often, a manager evaluates his effectiveness by the quantitative criteria used to measure productivity. It is possible, unfortunately, for an operation to be poorly managed or inappropriately managed, but still be effective in terms of output. The result is usually high staff turnover and little loyalty to the manager involved. In fact, the most accurate indicator of an effective manager is a dedicated and productive staff.
Well, that's a reflection of the individual's personality. And there, it appears that you very seldom see similar styles. Each individual performs in his own fashion. And if you tend to be a quiet, soft-spoken individual, then perhaps you are quietly persuasive with your subordinates. If you tend to be a bombastic, enthusiastic individual, then perhaps you carry on in that fashion. I think the point there is that not all management styles are suitable to all employees, so that what you find happening is that that particular manager tends then to gather around him a workforce that is agreeable to and reacts well to his particular style of management.
Management, the process of achieving goals through the efforts of others. Planning, staffing, directing, organizing, and control. Effective management is an art. Never perfected, improved with practice. A good manager enjoys a refreshing, rewarding relationship with his employees. But remember, managers themselves are also managed by upper echelon executives. With the authority, prestige, and monetary benefits of a managerial position come total accountability for subordinates. A good manager must be ready to assume total responsibility for error, inefficiency, or problems within his department. He acts on behalf of his employees as a liaison between them and his own superiors. On the other hand, he gets tremendous reward out of watching his staff perform and gives credit where credit is due. Management as a career opportunity exists in every field of business. Regardless of the nature of the work, whether it be construction or computers or commercial banking, there are always people striving towards some corporate objective. People needing direction, plans, staffing, organization, and control. People needing managers.
Join Bob Newhart, Dave Thomas, and Martin Mull, just to name a few, as they yuck it up at the Montreal International Comedy Festival, just for laughs, a Citytv special presentation tonight at 8.
Information about enrolling in this or any other credit course, certificate, or diploma program in business, tourism, computer, retail floristry, social services, design arts, and early childhood education at Seneca College's Center for Independent Learning, please call 491-5050, extension 4825, or drop in at 43 Shepherd Avenue East at Yonge Street, Monday through Friday, between 9 a.m. and 5 p.m.
Hey, how's the food in there? From Queen East and Kenilworth, this is Citytv, everywhere.
The following program depicts exercises which, depending upon your physical condition, may be hazardous to your health. You are therefore warned not to attempt any of these exercises without consulting your doctor. Even with such approval, each exercise should be done in moderation and should not be performed if tired or to the point of fatigue or pain. Do not overexert yourself. This is the 20-minute workout. The exercise show that benefits the most important muscle in your body, your heart. Scientifically developed, the 20-minute workout offers the maximum aerobic benefit in the minimum amount of time. Begin slowly, working at your own pace, and watch the times in the corner of the screen to set your goals for improvement. Be patient. Like any exercise program, it takes a while to learn the routine. Just try to do a little more each day. Give yourself enough room to move, wear comfortable clothing and aerobic shoes. Whether you're a beginner or in great physical condition, the 20-minute workout is for you. Enjoy it. Part of the fun is learning the movements of aerobics. Michelle is showing you the step kick to the side and front. Let your arms swing freely at your sides. Pick your feet up in the back with a hop, and then kick it forward with a hop. Step, kick, step, kick. Step lively, and remember to breathe out.
Did you know that nature has a fitness plan, too? It's winter, summer, spring, and fall. Now, if you don't exercise, your body's going to have the winter blahs all year round. Stay with me. I'll put the spring back in your body, the aerobic way.
Tequila.
Duracell, the one that lasts.
Refrigerators will keep 12-ounce spills from spilling all over. But Whirlpool has refrigerators that will do it today. Whirlpool. The day may come when all dishwashers will get your dishes sparkling clean and run quietly enough to let you talk on the phone. But isn't it nice to know Whirlpool Quiet Wash dishwashers will do it today?
Hello, I'm Rue McClanahan. Be sure to watch my new movie, Children of the Bride, coming to you on Citytv.
Margaret Becker, will you marry me?
Tonight on City, her new love left her children cold.
He's so young. I'm sorry.
I hope you're all going to accept John.
Welcome to the family. You've passed the initiation. Now, damn it, I want that woman to marry me, and because of all of you, she's doubting it.
Citytv presents Children of the Bride, 9 tonight.
This is New Orleans, darling. Folks have a certain way of doing things.
Wednesday, great movies. Cajun country really gets cooking.
What we got here is a cute little drug war.
You're a cop, for God's sake. You're supposed to uphold the law.
The Big Easy, 9 Wednesday in City.
Hello again. I'm Bess, working today with Michelle. And you. And dropping your head forward, pressing front and back. And front and back. Four, three. Right ear to your shoulder. Take your front and left and right and left. And four, three. And looking right and left. Take your right and left and right and left. Good. Four, three. Now reaching up, left and right. Take it left and right and left and right. All the way out of the ribcage, out of the shoulder. Four more. Three more. Two. And take that left arm over, pressing all the way. Good. Flat back. And dropping legs, releasing down. Through the center for two. Bend your knees, rolling up. Right arm comes over. Take it all the way. Good. And flat back. Now dropping leg, releasing down. And take it through the center. Bend your knees, press it
Normal. Three more. Two. Straight leg. Rest. Press the hip right. And press the hip left. And take it to the center. Other leg comes up. Left side now. Five, six. Point that toe. And up. Good. Exhale. Exhale.
Extra calories per day will increase your weight by 10 pounds per year.
If cooking is hit or miss, reach for the ultimate cleaning machine, SOS. Nothing slices through messes on stovetops, casseroles, or utensils faster. SOS, the ultimate cleaning machine. If dinner gets a little too attached to your grill, reach for the ultimate cleaning machine, SOS. Nothing cuts the dirt on grills, white walls, or golf clubs faster. SOS, the ultimate cleaning machine.
Today's fashionable shoppers are heading to Honest Ed's world-famous bargain house in Toronto, where clothing and jewelry are a real steal. Major credit cards are welcomed at Honest Ed's 14 full-range departments, including jewelry. Plenty of gems from Ed's gold mine. Men's, ladies, and children's clothing, a closet full of bargains, and shoe sales that'll set your tongues a-wagon. Conveniently located on the Bloor subway line at Bathurst. And remember, Honest Ed's all wet.
But I've never soaked you yet.
I ain't no lady, Gino. I'm a Santangelo, just like you.
Sunday, Jackie Collins' bestseller comes to city, Lucky Chances, a tale of ambition.
What do you want to do, own the world?
Why not?
Love.
Can I help it if every man that sees me wants me?
And revenge.
Santino's got Bobby.
Spanning 40 years in two continents, the gripping drama unfolds in lavish splendor.
I don't need your father's money, Olympia.
You can't miss Jackie Collins' Lucky Chances, a three-part miniseries starting Sunday at 9.
It used to be possible to be creative in Berlin because it was a quite cheap city.
This weekend at FT, West Berlin's avant-garde style.
Is it getting cold?
No, I said it's enough of loving myself.
I think I try to build buildings that fit in.
Architect Adrian Smith creates a new skyline.
Some of these sketches were done on airplanes. You know, the old napkin trick.
Plus supermodel Cindy Crawford, all on FT Fashion Television, Saturday at 7:30 and Sunday at 6:30.
We're back. Are you? Didn't stop twisting, did you?
I know you didn't.
And left and right. Stomach tight, shoulders down, all the way. I'm pressing out. Make sure you're breathing now. Keep on going, all the way. Left and right. Four more. Three more. Two more. And now press those feet apart and take it apart. Good. Push those heels down. Arms let go. Pull them back together. Four more. Three more. Two more. And feet apart again. Don't stop. Come on, dig in. Go. All the way. And pull them back together. Four more. Three more. Two more. Last set with feet apart. Come on. Rest it out. Rest it out. All the way. All the way. And pull it back in. Four more. Three more. Good. Two more. Hands up. Double each side. Take it left and right. Left and right. Come on. Go on the oil. Stomach tight. Four. Three more. Two more. And going back to single now. Left and right. Keep on breathing. Four more. Three more. Two more. And right knee up in. Eight, seven, six, five, four, three, two. Left side up and take it. Eight, seven, six, five, four, three. Right side up in four, four, three, two. Left side, four, three. Right side up again, four, three, two. Left side, come on, and four, three, and double these sides. Stay with me, two, one, two, and one. Come on, don't stop, don't stop. Four more, three more, two more. Single right and left and take it back. And left, and right, and left. Knee up, all the way. Four, three more, two more. And step, kick forward, take it right and left, right and left. Four, three, press it to the side. Four more, three more, two. And single front, front, side, side, front, front, side. Side, front, front, side, side. Four more, three more, two more. And right arm reaches up, take it up and out. Come on, take it out, shot, and out. All the way, good, all the way. Four more, three more, two more. And going for the single, take the right and left, add that hip. Push those arms to the side and out and in. Four, three, straight arms up again and take it up. Four, three, breath into the side. Four more, three more, two, back to double reach up. Take it right and left, right and left. Two more, and feet pressed out and in. Let it go, take it out and in, out and in. Arms crossed in front. Four, three, double out and in. Come on, and out and in, out and in, out and in. Exhale now, four more, three more, two more. And take it back to single, push it out and in. Four, three, two, arms down, stay with me. Four more, three more, two more. Jumping jack, your favorite part, I know it is. Come on, up, and up, don't stop your rhythm now. Come on, all the way. Exhale, stomach down, don't hold your breath, just four more. Three more, two, arms crossing in and up. Take it in, and out, exhale, exhale. Four more, three more, two more. Both arms, pull it down and take it. Step, down. And pull in from the side, take it. Exhale. left and right and take it left, right, left, right. Inhaling up. Anna. 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 Two more times up. Anna. And last time up. Anna. Left arm comes over. Press over. Anna. 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 Two more. Flat back. Press through center. Arm comes over. And reach it up. Other way. Good. Right arm over. Flat back. Same thing. And through the center. Left arm over. Lift up. Free feet. You got it. All the way over. Flat back. Cross the center. Right arm over. Last time. And right arm over. Flat back. To the center. Left arm over. Lift up. And turn all the way. Nice and slow. And repeat down all the way. Two more. Dropping your head forward now. Press front and front. And back. And front. And back. And forward. Three. Reach up right arm and left and take it right. And left, and right, and left. Four, three. Now both arms stay up. Flat back, press it over. Arms to the side. And take it down. Walk the hands forward. Lift those heels. Press them up. And hang it up. And up. And up. Don't stop breathing. Come on. And up. Good. All the way. On the floor, push back, relax, all right, hands inside the knees, now work that right shoulder, going forward, three, two, left shoulder, four, three, right side again, four count, don't stop, three, two, left shoulder, four, three, taking it to the single, release it right. Breath and just four more. On the same. Three more. Slowly lift it up. Two more. And one. Now reaching out and take it right. And right. And right. And right. Four. Three. And dropping your head forward. Releasing front. And back. And front. And back. Drop the head from the left to the right. Take it left to right. And right to left. Repeat. Down and right and down. Now full circle to the right. Push front, right, back, and reverse. Take it back, right, front, and inhale. Take it up and out. And up. And out. All the way up.
For good health, a man's body fat should not exceed 19% of his total weight. A woman's body fat should not exceed 22% of her total.
One, two, and bend. And stretch. Good. And reach. That's it. And crawl. Come on. And bend and stretch and reach and crawl.
When you don't have the right tools to clean with, housework becomes quite a workout. But before you...
Go for the burn. Go for the burn.
Go for the Rubbermaid. Now Rubbermaid makes a whole line of cleaning products, many with handles specially designed to help you handle housework. Now, doesn't that work out nicely? And don't you wish everything was made like Rubbermaid?
Tequila. Duracell, the one that lasts.
Yes, assignment, I'm tending to that location.
Toronto fire group, get out to an assist call.
News 17 is 1023 with a fire ticket.
Nobody brings you Toronto's news faster than the City Pulse News team every night at 6 and 10.
Welcome to an aerobic minute, brought to you for your health and happiness. Jess is demonstrating sit-ups to work your abdominal muscles. Lie down on the floor with your knees up and hands behind your head. Keep your stomach muscles in and your shoulders off the floor. Now arms across the chest. Take it up and up. Press the small of your back to the floor. Stay strong and keep breathing. If you don't feel you can go at this pace, don't worry. Just stay with the music and a movement you can do comfortably. Now hands come to the side. Palms go up and down. Aerobic exercise gives you better energy and endurance. That's the 20-minute workout way, and that's it for today.
Did you wake up some of those sleeping muscles? Bring your body out of hibernation. You'll find yourself blossoming into a beautiful new you. I'll see you again. Till then, you stay fit.
Rise and shine. It's breakfast time with David Onley, Ann Romer, and Steve Anthony. Breakfast Television next.
The 20-minute workout instructors wear the Reebok Freestyle, the number one aerobic shoe in the world, available in a rainbow of colors at fine stores everywhere. Wardrobes furnished by Danskin. Danskin, not just for dancing. While in Toronto, the cast stayed at the elegant Sutton Place Hotel.
City Pulse weatherman Harold Hossein has a lot riding on his shoulders. Toronto's fastest weather expert is the official consultant to Skydome.
Okay, guys, open her up.
Dependable weather, City Pulse every night at 6 and 10. Watching City's intergalactic mural develop at Queen and John, this is Citytv everywhere.
One, two, three, go. We're pieces of train, so get out of bed. It's time to start your morning. We're pieces of train, so get out of bed. It's time to start your day. We're pieces of train, so get out of bed. It's time to start your morning. We're pieces of train, so get out of bed. It's time to start your day. Yeah.